Darren Vaught here with another USA Baseball alum. This time it's the pride of the Florida Gators, Matt LaPorta, several times a USA Baseball alum, including in the Olympics. What else can you say? Seventh overall pick in 2007, just a storied collegiate career, and then a career in professional baseball afterward. Two-time SEC Player of the Year. Did I say that, Matt? How are you, man?
That's right. Yeah, I'm doing great, Darren. Thanks for having me on the show. And yeah, not a lot of people know the two-time part, and I think that is a record still.
I think so. I think you're right. One record that I know still stands: all-time home run leader at Florida. So that, of course, was right around the time you represented Team USA with the collegiate national team. Let's start there and revisit your experience. All right.
Yeah.
How did that prepare you in the transition from a great storied collegiate career to making the jump to professional baseball? Because at that time, look, I mean, you played in the SEC. You were no stranger to a semblances of talent necessarily. Was that the most talent you had ever played with on a single team, though?
Ooh, yeah. That was the most talent I've ever played with on one team. I mean, we had some studs. I mean, David Price, Max Scherzer, Chris Perez, John Jay, Shane Robinson, Ian Kennedy. I mean, Mark Melanson, J.P. Arencibia, Matt Wieters. I mean, I could keep going on. I mean, that team was full of studs.
So how was your mindset when you got there to first play with that team as someone who was playing in the SEC, had seen a ton of success already? Was there sort of just like a wow moment for you, or how did that play in your mind with gathering with that kind of collection of players?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was an honor to be a part of that and to be with that group of talented players, and then to make the team. I mean, because again, I got to imagine that's probably one of the most special collegiate USA teams that we've had. I could be wrong. I could be biased. Oh,
no, it checks out. As somebody who like regularly covers a lot of them, it checks out. The names you just listed, I mean, that's a loaded. You know?
I mean, there could be like one or two Hall of Fame guys on there, you know. But it was, it was a great experience to be out there with those guys.
What do you recall about finding out that you were going to get the chance to play with Team USA?
Yeah, I mean, I was my college coach, you know, called me in and said, "Hey, would you want to play? You know, Team USA this year? They invited you to play." And I was like, absolutely, I want to do that. I mean, I think anytime you can represent your country and then do it with really at that time the best of the best, you know, in the U.S. that was in the collegiate level, is pretty neat. And to travel abroad to play baseball, I mean, you can't beat that.
That's the other thing, too, is I love asking guys, especially – at the younger age groups, of course, we've got the younger teams, and it goes all the way down to a 12U level and things like that. Mm-hmm. At such a young age, you have not been exposed to other baseball cultures by that point, right? Yeah. And a lot of times you have a kid who probably hasn't traveled outside of the country, if so, maybe just once. Mm-hmm. What was that element of your USA Baseball experience like, especially, I would assume that was sort of the start of it with the collegiate team?
Yeah, I had played one time outside of the country when I was like 15 or 16. Went to like Australia and played. But outside of that, like USA was it, man, where we got to go to, you know, Japan, Taiwan, and play. I'm trying to think, did we play anywhere else? Taipei, anyway. But that was really the first time. And then the first time I got to play in the Asian culture, which was unbelievable. I mean, the way they get into the baseball games over there is like Premier League soccer. I mean, everybody's got their chants and hollering and the whole game. I've never seen anything like it. It was incredible.
The Premier League soccer is a good comparison. I don't know that I've ever heard that one when talking about that. Well, what about the Olympics experience was different, because that was in 2008. And by that point, I mean, it wasn't that far removed from your collegiate national team experience. What differed about the two?
Well, obviously you're playing for a medal, like, you know, gold, silver, bronze type deal. And you're representing your country on even a much greater platform, right? We're talking about the Olympics. I mean, only happens, you know, once every 4 years, except for this year because it got canceled. But, yeah. You know, that was just a tremendous experience to get to do that and to represent the U.S., you know, not only on the field, but represent the U.S. as a person, as a man, you know, as somebody coming to a different country, meaning China, and just, you know, trying to live out how an American lives out, right? Like, just courteous and kind to other cultures and people. And so it was a phenomenal opportunity and experience to be a part of.
Was there a moment when you participated in the Olympics that it clicked in that way? Like, you know, this all these years later, I expect the perspective that you just gave of, you know, it's the grandest stage that there is in terms of international athletics. Mm-hmm. You're still a pretty young guy at the time. Was there a moment that maybe like you were there and you witnessed something, or you just took something in and it clicked, and it was just like, man, I am at the Olympics representing the United States, that changed things?
I mean, for me, like I said, it was such an honor to be asked to participate in that. And I think a lot of things had to go right. Like your MLB team had to release you or allow you to play in that. And so I just found myself to be very fortunate to go to that. And I always said, didn't realize that was going to happen, but I always said that if baseball ended right after the Olympics for me, I felt like my career in baseball was fulfilled. Like, because the Olympics is something that nobody can ever take away from you. You know, and again, obviously I get if you make an MVP in the big leagues or a Cy Young, all these things, they can't take that away from you either. But I don't know, just to me, that just this just representing our country is like, just so many, you know, so few people have ever done that. You know, on the Olympic stage, it was just, yeah, truly an honor for me.
So then the obvious goal is gold. You guys didn't quite reach that. You got the bronze medal. So like, you medaled at the Olympics, and you've already laid it out in a way that, you know, not that you were just happy to be there. You were playing to win gold. How did that change your feeling of the accomplishment? I mean, you were on the medal stand. That's something.
Yeah. I mean, that is truly something to hear, you know, A, the U.S. baseball team be announced, get your medal, and then they play the song, you know, that you always hear. And just that was a humbling experience, you know, and one that I'll never forget. And obviously, at the time, right, like, we should have got bronze, or we should have got silver, or should have got gold. But at the same time, we still got bronze, right? I mean, we could have walked away and didn't get anything. So, you know, that competitor wants to get, you know, be the best. But that year, Korea was just, I mean, they were lights out. And I do believe, you know, we could have, you know, one fall here, one ball fall there, or whatever, one play we make, we could have had silver as well. We just, you know, didn't go our way. So, you know.
In working things out chronologically here, the best I can, Matt, it wasn't long after that, man, you had like one hit after another early in your career here, right? With your success collegiately, with us, with the collegiate national team, then the Olympics. Shortly after, you made your pro debut or your major league debut with the Indians. Mm-hmm. How did that compare? Because by this point in your life, I'm fascinated by guys' mindsets as far as their goal setting is concerned. And you get to a point when you start to play for these teams, like the collegiate national team, where you start to differentiate between like dreams and goals, right? Yeah. These started to become attainable goals for you at a certain point. And just one by one, you're knocking them down. How did something like the Olympics compare to a major league debut that I'm sure you had dreamt of since you were, a little kid?
That's a great question, Darren. So for me, you know, the Olympics was never like a goal to be a part of, you know, just because you think of Olympics, you think of swimming, you think of track and field. You don't necessarily think of baseball all the time, which I'm glad they're bringing it back in.
Yeah.
But you know, you don't necessarily think about that all the time, right? So for baseball, it's always get to the big leagues, have a nice long career. And so there were really two different emotions that went with it. Like, the Olympics was an amazing experience that I was blessed to just kind of fell in my lap, right? Right timing. The Olympics just, you know, it was all about timing, right? And kind of luck. The big league debut was just a lot of sweat and tears and energy and effort that went into it. And again, it doesn't stop once you have your debut, right? Like, the working hard and all that. That's just, all right, now you're in the game, right? You're in the game. But there's a ton of emotions, because not only are you emotionally invested, but your mom, your dad, your family. I can remember the night I got called up, you know, calling my parents, and all of us just crying. Like, man, we made it. We made it. We did this. We accomplished this goal that we had set out to do. And because they've been to the college games sitting in 100 degree weather out in the bleachers at University of Florida. And, you know, I look back, I'm like, man, I don't know if I could do that for my kids, man. It's too hot out here. but just so a lot more emotions went into it, because it's been a dream for so long, versus the Olympics is like, oh yeah, that's 2008. That'd be cool if you're on the team, and then you play well and you're on the team.
Yeah. No, it was sort of just like a side road on
the
highway. Yeah. And I love that you said, when you talked to your parents, you were like, we made it. Because you can of course relate to this. I'm sure others watching can too. Any kind of success, it's not just one person. They have their supporters and their advisors and things like that. Mm-hmm. Talk about that a little bit more for me, because you mentioned your mom, your dad. I'm sure any teammate you've ever had in sports, from a young age even to more recently prior to your debut, everyone is invested in this moment over the span of your life, and then that's when it happens, right? So, like, walk me through the night of making your debut. Like, who all do you hear from? Was it people in some cases that you hadn't heard from in forever? What did that overall picture look like? And I'm sure you had reminders all over the place of just like where you had been along the way.
Yeah. So the night of my debut, so the day I got called up, I didn't play that first day, which was a little like nerve wracking. I'm like, man, you just called me up. I need to be out on the field. I don't need to be sitting in here in this dugout. And it would have been the fifth starter. We were playing in Detroit. So I would have got somebody.
Hittable, more hittable, right?
More hittable, maybe, you know. Instead, I get ran out the next day against Justin Verlander. So that's a whole nother, I was like, gosh dang, man. I got to face this guy. He might have been a Cy Young that year.
Yeah.
the texts were coming in and the calls from different people that I hadn't heard of in a while that obviously followed my career and my journey. But no doubt, man, there was a lot of people along the way that helped me get to where I was at. You know, you ask any successful business guy or successful athlete, like, you can't do it without a team of people. And if you do, it's going to be short-lived, because you just can't sustain it for that long. And so, but my parents were always, right there with me, very helpful and encouraging. And I mean, there was times where, my freshman year of college, I wanted to quit. I felt like a failure because I didn't start until later on in the season. And it just was an emotional wreck. And you know, was depressed and God, what am I doing? Why I suck? How come I'm not playing? And so, you know, mom and dad were there and they, hey man, if you want to quit, you know, finish out the season and be done with it. Or my mom, you know, or push through, you know, there was always these just little bits of encouragement and guidance throughout that process. And grateful that I listened to them.
Well, I appreciate how open you're being about these sorts of things, because the next question might not be as fun a subject. You played 4 years in the bigs.
Yeah.
Tried to eke out what you could, and then ultimately came the decision to retire in 2015. Yeah. Just as a guy, I played at a very small collegiate level, but at some point had to come to terms with you're not a player anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
So I know and have talked to others whose, you know, decisions were harder than others. It's just, it's a difficult thing for any athlete just to know that you're done. What played into that for you in 2015?
Yeah, so a lot of people don't know that I've had three hip surgeries. You know, I had one in 2009 on my labrum, and then again to scope my hip out in 2012 on the same hip. And, you know, I had my hip replaced in 2017. So, you know, a lot of people don't know that backstory of like, you know, what happened to him? Why did he all of a sudden just suck? I mean, I probably was getting dominated, but I don't think I was that bad. You know, it was a little bit of injury. But to answer your question, so, I mean, you know, you've already talked about all the highlights that I've had in my career. And so we get to 2014. So 2013, rewind there. I rehabbed that whole year. So nobody really saw me play. I'd come out, play a week, and my hip would be killing me, shut me down again. And so that happened the entire season. So 2014 rolls around. Nobody's really picking me up. I'm in February now. I'm like, okay, I don't have a job. What's going on? The Orioles call me. Hey, why don't you come to spring training with us? All right, cool. And they're only, you know, an hour away from the house. So I go and do that, right? They end up releasing me, I don't know, two days before camp ends. So I was like, well, that stinks, because it's hard to find a job when you get released that late.
Yeah.
So I was like, shoot, what am I going to do? We just had our twin boys. So I had three kids then at that time. And I was like, man, well, I don't know what I'm going to do. So I kind of sat around just, I don't know, figuring out, contemplating what's going on, what's the next step. And a team from Mexico called me. And I never in my wildest dreams ever thought I'd go to Mexico to play baseball, ever, right? So, hey, the Campeche Pirates or Piratas called me and said, hey, you want to come over and play? I'm like, well, I worked hard all off season. Let's see if I can go over there and do well and maybe get a shot at Korea or Japan. So I go over there. I leave my wife with her three kids and the two newborn babies. So I get over there, and I mean, it's just a whole nother world, buddy. We get there, there's, you know, the AC, not really any AC in the locker room. The toilet, there's no toilet seats. There's no stall doors on the toilets. Cold showers. I will have to say I had an amazing view of the Gulf of Mexico from my hotel room. And then there was a Starbucks 500 feet from the hotel at a new mall they just built. So, I mean, I literally lived in my hotel room and that Starbucks. I mean, until the game started, right? Or BP and all that.
Yeah.
And I was going and I was playing and my hip was just starting to hurt again. And I just got to a point where I was like, I can't do this. So, I was probably wearing my friend out, Travis Hafner. I was calling him because he had just retired, I think, the year before or whatever. And I was, you know, so I'm calling him from Mexico. Hey, man, you know, I'm thinking about I'm done. Like, what was that process like for you? We probably went through that for several weeks before I ended up, okay, I'm done, which was a very emotional thing. And, again, never in my wildest dreams I thought I'd go to Mexico and play baseball. But I would tell you it was one of the most humbling experiences that I had. And when I left there, I was full of joy because I'll never forget the guys there were watching big league games on their, you know, TV in the locker room, and just knowing that at one point I was a guy that they were probably watching.
Yeah.
And that was, it just brought joy to my heart. Like, man, I made it, didn't get to play as long as I wanted to, didn't work out the way I wanted it to, but I made it where a lot of these guys got no shot at making it. Not because they don't have the talent, they just, it's really hard, you know, to make it from Mexico. So I'll never forget, man, I called it like a team meeting. Because, I mean, all the guys loved me, and I loved all the guys. They were great. And, you know, called a team meeting and just said, hey, guys, thank you so much for this opportunity to be with you. But today's my last game. And it was difficult. I mean, I was like, I mean, I was crying. I think a couple other guys were crying in there. Like, it was like a piece of me. I'm leaving. I'm dying, you know. So, but I honestly wouldn't change how I went out of the game for anything. It was a good experience, and it brought me back to why I played baseball, just to have fun. You know, it was a game that we were good at.
Yeah,
the joy of it. So,
That's really good stuff, man. Seeing as how this is going to release and be seen rolling up to the holiday season. Just like baseball is nostalgic for all those reasons, let's tap into something that's perhaps just as fun and memorable. What comes to mind when you think of the holidays?
Oh yeah. So when I think of the holidays, I think of there are these little desserts called Kringles. They're out of Racine, Wisconsin.
Okay.
They are amazing. If you've never bought a Kringle, I highly recommend that you go do it. You can order it. They deliver it, ship it to your house. They're like these little pastries, these Danish pastries, and they're incredible. I mean, I just ordered 20 of them for the holiday season.
Hold on. How does this start and become somewhat of a holiday tradition for you?
Yeah, great question. So one of the guys that I play baseball with, Vinny Rattino, I think he was from that area up there, and he, you know, during the season, every once in a while, he would bring in, you know, he'd go home or something on a break and bring in a Kringle when he'd come back. And I mean, I would murder these things. Gone. You know, I'd give him some extra money, buy me an extra one.
Yeah.
And I would tell my aunt, hey, you got to try these things. These are amazing. And it was, I guess it was coming in the holiday season. So she just, every holiday, she started buying me some. And so she still buys them, but I still, you know, I still stack up on them because honestly, they're great. Like, they're great food to bring to like a dinner party or a Christmas party. Like, I mean, Kringles are a hit, man. I'm telling
okay.
you.
Okay. No, noted.
No, note that.
That in mind.
Yeah.
So maybe we got to spin this next question. So is it a, if you're, it's a non-food gift, but
okay.
What's your favorite gift that you ever received? Maybe baseball related, maybe not.
Man, that's a good one. I gotta think about that. Probably it would probably go back to, man, when I was a kid. My parents. Got me a basketball, like they built a basketball court and a basketball hoop for me out back.
Yeah.
So it was like a little half court type, maybe not even a half court, right? It was much smaller than a half court, but you know, they had been working on it, got it poured and all that. And we were like, hey, we got a surprise out back and here's my basketball hoop. And we wore that. I sucked at basketball. I was definitely not good. I mean, I just saw my eighth grade basketball coach at a wedding, and we were talking sports. And, man, remember when we played basketball? And he goes, yeah, you were terrible, man. I go, it's amazing I made it this far in baseball. I go, I was so bad at basketball. But that was, like, one of my favorite gifts. I loved it. We played on it as kids so much. It was great.
Nice. That's a good one. Do you have any, besides the Kringles now, any holiday traditions that you've carried on? You mentioned your children from, you know, a generation to another generation.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that we do, we always read the, you know, the Christmas story, not the movie Christmas story, but, you know, we read the Christmas story and kind of, you know, so it's like 12 pages. It's a quick read for the kids. And we sit there and read that. And then a lot of, you know, we still, you know, we'll open gifts in the morning, on Christmas Day. And yeah. And then we've started doing, like, we try to everybody wear the same, you know, pajamas or whatever, you know, so like I'll get the same, you know, we'll all have the same pajamas on. So
that's, I don't take this as a compliment because it certainly is one. Your personality strikes me as the type of person to embrace that kind of tradition and have a lot of fun with it. Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah, I love it.
So we talked about favorite gift, that sort of thing. Over at usabaseballshop.com, as you are well aware, plenty that is just ripe for the picking for your holiday shopping. Is there something over there that strikes you as something that you would want to put on your wish list?
Yeah, I mean, they, you know, like I was telling you about my Christmas outfits and stuff that we all, you know, wear the same as a family. But there's a pair of, like, and I love ugly sweater Christmas parties. Like, I love those. But there's a pair of socks that are like, they're red, but they're ugly sweater Christmas socks or something. So I'm looking at those. You know, to go with one of my ensembles. I don't know what it'll be, what I wear, but, you know.
A fantastic choice by my estimation, Matt. Well, look, we really do appreciate your time doing this and sitting down and chatting with us for a few minutes. Certainly appreciate your time with Team USA. We're proud to have you as a member of the family. And in the meantime, best wishes to you and yours, and go Gators. I'll give you a go Gators.
Yeah, go Gators. Yeah. Yep. Thanks, Darren. I appreciate it. This was, this was great. I love reconnecting with USA Baseball. And, you know, you guys do a great job over there.